Hachette Audio presents The Da Vinci Women, The Untold Feminist Power of Leonardo's Art. Written by Kia Vahland. Read by Ana Clements. Be sure to look out for your bonus PDF to reference the artwork plates and illustrations mentioned in the audio. Preface. Painting is feminine, or at least it is in the case of Leonardo da Vinci. From his early Madonnas, plates 1 and 2, to the late Virgin and Child with St. Anne, plate 23, from the first portrait he painted, Ginevra da Benci, plate 9, to the Mona Lisa, plate 28, the main figures in Leonardo's paintings are women. Only two men are featured as protagonists in the surviving panel paintings that are definitely by Leonardo. One is St. Jerome, plate 14, the unfinished picture of an old man praying in the desert as he struggles to renounce worldly temptations. The other is the John the Baptist, plate 29, which Leonardo painted at the end of his life, where the youthful subject is both self-assured and sensual. We would have to include all the disciples in the fresco of the Last Supper, plate 19, and all the figures of the baby Jesus in the images of the Madonna in order to reach anywhere near a balance between the sexes. Even Joseph did not manage to appear in Leonardo's paintings of the Holy Family. Instead, the artist usually assigns his place to St. Anne, the mother of Mary, plates 22 and 23. Painted portraits of kings, popes, or princes are lacking altogether, as far as we know. He left us only a sketch for one portrait of a ruler, which also shows a woman. Isabella d'Este, the Marchioness of Mantua, plate 20. Leonardo da Vinci did more for the visibility of women than any other painter. In the 20th and 21st centuries, he has been perceived in a different way, however, as a technical pioneer who anticipated the inventions of the modern era with his drawings of flying machines, weapons systems, and lifting devices. Yet this is too one-sided. Leonardo enjoyed designing all kinds of machines on paper, but they were hardly ever built. If these feats of engineering had been the most important thing in his life, he would have been a failure. Leonardo's machines make up only a small part of his vast body of drawings. He worked extensively on human anatomy, geological history, and the growth of plants, and constantly returned to his great passion, the movement of winds and water. He drew in order to understand the world, and he sought to understand the world in order to paint it. For him, painting was the greatest of all the sciences and the defining medium of his age. At the easel, man becomes a creator and can feel his kinship with Mother Nature, the great creator. If Leonardo sometimes struggled in the studio, adding brushstrokes very slowly, one by one, it was because he was thinking so deeply about what he wanted to paint and how to depict it. He was a philosophical painter, as his amazed contemporaries remarked. A man who worked because he was interested in understanding things and because he had something he wanted to tell people. The knowledge at the center of Leonardo's painting is the knowledge of women. Even in antiquity, the painting of a beautiful woman was evidence of a painter's skill. Her power to seduce was also his. Leonardo once gleefully recounted how viewers rapturously kissed the women in his paintings. Up until his time, young ladies in Italian portraits were depicted only in chaste profile. Leonardo was the first to turn his female figures to face the viewer, allowing an intimate dialogue between them. Leonardo's women have a soul and a strong will. They move in space and time. They are beings in their own right in an age when women had no rights. Leonardo's belle donne have what the poet Petrarch once found lacking in portraits of women. Voce ed intellecto, voice and intellect. Together with his female models, the artist revealed the independent, self-assured woman, and in his works, she became man's equal. Leonardo da Vinci was not a feminist. This concept simply did not exist around 1500. He did not fight for equal legal and social rights for women, because there were no such struggles in Renaissance times. However, there was a lively debate about whether women thought in the same way as men, and whether or not they could love. As can be understood from Baldassare Castiglione's Book of the Courtier, this was the subject of discussion between the enemies and supporters of women. Some men with a humanist education despised women and thought of them as objects, while others respected and admired them. In his writings, drawings, and paintings, Leonardo da Vinci positioned himself on the side of women, so his art developed a feminist power centuries before the emancipation of women. For him, women's ability to feel, think, and make decisions was beyond question. He therefore warned men that they should not be inconsiderate in their attitude towards sex, because women must be able to feel desire during the sexual act so that the child they deliver will be understanding, intelligent, lively, and lovable. For Leonardo, women's ability to give birth was an act of creation. They were creators, and in his opinion, painters are also creators because they produce something new in their art. That is also why he felt so close to women. By allying himself with women, Leonardo also emancipated art. It was no longer a wish machine for clients, but had an intangible life of its own. His Mary is at peace with herself, not subject to an annunciatory angel, and his paintings were not subject to the wishes of his patrons. Leonardo kept the paintings that really meant something to him in his home until the end of his life. These included the Mona Lisa and the Virgin and Child with St. Anne. Both works combined the feminine with the history of nature and the earth, which the artist displayed in background landscapes. In Leonardo's opinion, an individual woman can stand for the whole of nature because she shares with nature the gift of giving life. This ability to keep making a fresh start enables the human race constantly to redesign its existence. The bird lover, hill walker, and vegetarian treats uncontrollable nature with its seas and cliffs, its animals and plants, with deep respect. And Leonardo demanded the same from the viewers of his art. So the idea that Leonardo's drawings of armored vehicles and plans for diverting rivers mean that he wanted to subjugate the world is erroneous. Yes, he went to war and accompanied the butcher Cesare Borgia on a campaign of conquest. However, he quite openly condemned what he saw. He referred to war as pazzia bestialissima, a most bestial madness, and used it in his cartoon for a painting of the Battle of Anghiari, which concerned the hopelessness of violent conflicts. The distorted image of Leonardo as a techie and the ideal model of a virile man goes back to a Leonardo exhibition in Milan in 1939 at the start of World War II. The Italian dictator, Benito Mussolini, who declared himself to be the greatest living Italian, wanted this exhibition to celebrate the greatest Italian of the past. Models of Leonardo's machines that were never built in his lifetime were exhibited for the first time, and his deeply humanistic nude drawing of the Vitruvian Man, illustration 21, in a circle and a square, was now said to represent the technophile man of the future, who has almost become a machine himself. The image of Leonardo as the unrelenting rationalist continued to have an effect after the end of the fascist period. In the late 20th century, it was still influencing the pioneers of the computer industry, who discovered Leonardo's designs when they were on the lookout for a forebear and subsequently claimed him as their own, although no longer the warrior, but Leonardo the engineer and technical visionary. This was probably the reason why in 1994, Bill Gates bought Leonardo's scientific manuscript, the Codex Lester. A gap still remained. Leonardo's women, for whose presence on the stage of art and natural history the artist had done so much, were ignored and overlooked. And one more thing has fallen by the wayside: the realization that, in his old age, Leonardo reinvented the male image, creating figures that were just as sensual, self-willed, and close to nature as his women. The year 2019 marked the 500th anniversary of Leonardo da Vinci's death. It is time to look back without prejudice, examine his paintings and drawings, and read his texts, and to listen to him and the contemporary witnesses who knew him personally. This biography of the artist does that through detailed study of the sources. As well as Leonardo's artistic works, there are analyses of his writings on art and nature, unpublished in his lifetime, and his diary-like notes on everyday life. There are also letters and statements from contemporaries, legal documents, tax and court records, and other papers. This wide range of evidence enables us to make a critical examination of later judgments, such as those of the art writer Giorgio Vasari. Information on the sources with the original Italian and Latin quotations, as well as references to the status of art history and historical research, can be found in the downloadable bonus PDF at the end of the audiobook. In addition to Leonardo's life and works and the art of his time, the book deals with the socio-historical and political circumstances during the period when this exceptional artist was active. For instance, the first chapter is about Leonardo's early Madonnas and also the role of mothers and their infants in the Renaissance, while the fourth chapter shows, on the one hand, how love was celebrated in Florence in richly symbolic spectacles, and on the other hand, how men who loved men were persecuted. Leonardo da Vinci was the illegitimate son of a notary and a simple peasant woman. In consequence, he was denied a higher education. As a young man, he was once accused of sodomy, homosexual activities. His origins and his desires made him an outsider in society. However, this appears to have proven fortunate. Instead of living in a patriarchal family structure, he lived with his pupils and lovers in a home and work community. He put orthodox opinions to the test. He went his own way, took nothing for granted, drew and painted, researched and wrote whatever came into his head. As a result, he was able to empathize with his figures, both female and male, and also to follow the birth and death of nature. This is not a story of a virile male genius and female victims. It is about a vibrant creative collaboration. The artist's enormous inner freedom, his boundless imagination, and his ability to project himself into the minds of others constitute the universality of Leonardo's creative work. Chapter 1. Childhood. He is thriving. He is well-fed, alert, and loved. The surprisingly large infant is sitting naked on a comfortable velvet cushion. His mother has such a firm, secure grasp on his back that her fingertips leave an impression in his baby fat. Plate 1. No harm can come to him. Or so it seems. His left leg is kicking out, as if he wanted to try his strength against an imaginary opponent. But there is nobody there. Just the two of them in their dark, almost cave-like palazzo, with round arched windows that reveal the view of a shimmering blue mountain landscape. Warm light falls on the plump body of the infant, emphasizing his muscular torso and almost hairless head, but more particularly, it sculpts the bright face of the young mother and the low neckline of her dress. She is beautiful, with reserved, still girlish features, a small mouth and lowered eyelids under high, fair brows. And she has made herself look beautiful. It must have taken hours to braid her hair like this, with not a single strand falling over her forehead, and carefully controlled blonde ringlets tumbling out on either side of her cheeks from under a narrow veil framing her angelic face. Her deep blue robe is fastened with a transparent, shimmering rock crystal, and below its trimming of gold-embroidered braid, it gathers in wrinkles over her small breasts, which the infant is presumably still suckling. However, unlike the child, the mother is fully clothed. Under her mantle, she wears a high-fastening red gown with gathered sleeves, and she has a patterned silk shawl draped around her shoulders and back, and hanging down to her lap. The many lengths of fabric seem slightly antiquated, as if the late 15th century wearer were longing to be back in the ancient world. However, this is of no interest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.